This is Heart of Mind, and I'm Kathryn Davis. We have a very special program for you today, and it is going to be about transforming consciousness. And really, we're going to be sharing insights on what you can do to make your life better, more peaceful, happier, and really how to move through these energetic times that in many ways have a lot of challenges. We're going to be joined by Dr. J.J. Hurtak, Alan Steinfeld, and Dr. Desiree Hurtak. New insights begin with the understanding that we live in an interconnected world, and the observer is not aloof nor isolated from it, but remains connected to it throughout space-time and in other dimensions of experience. Understanding our interconnectedness releases us from our limitations and makes us part of the greater collective totality. This collective is understood to operate like a dynamic, growing, fractal-like process, with its extensions potentially endless. A new roadmap for humanity is appearing as we begin to see ourselves and all of humanity as cosmoplanetary quantum beings. And J.J. Hurtak, Ph.D., and Desiree Hurtak, Ph.D., are founders of the Academy for Future Science, an international non-governmental organization, NGO. They are social scientists and have written, translated, and published numerous books and texts. Their most recent book, co-authored by Dr. Elizabeth Rauscher, is called Mind Dynamics, which details the many years of remote viewing research and the scientific nature of consciousness. Dr. J.J. Hurtak is the author of The Keys of Enoch, a book on future cosmology, and he also co-authored the book End of Suffering with his colleague, physicist Russell Targ, the father of remote viewing, and he is from Stanford Research Institute. Since the 1970s, the Hurtaks have worked in the field of parapsychology and remote viewing research. Their work also includes archaeology, remote sensing, which is like radar, new energy technologies, space law, and consciousness development. So I'll start by saying hello to both of you, JJ and Desiree. Welcome to Heart of Mind.
Thank you so much for that great introduction. It's great to be with the heart and the mind together.
Yes, it's so important that we recognize all of ourselves as a whole rather than thinking maybe we're just the mind, because indeed we are so much more than just the mind.
Right, and we feel that it's so important to balance those energies. I'm glad that that was the title of your program, or it is the title of your program, because really some people just go off on their emotions, others on their rational thinking, and it's really the balance. And I think that's really what the time is right now. We have to find the balance within us.
Yes, current science is driven by the spotlight effect of looking only at a given object, a given something that they bring into notoriety. We're interested in looking at the whole spectrum of life and the power of consciousness.
That's so important. And I'm also wanting to introduce our third guest today, Alan Steinfeld. And for the last 20 or so years, he has traveled the globe looking for the most important contribution to the field of consciousness and is the host and producer of the New Realities television show, which airs on Time Warner Television in New York City. He has produced over 2,000 interview programs with the leading edge thinkers, scientists, artists, paradigm shifters, and religious leaders from around the world. And I want to say hello and welcome, Alan, to Heart of Mind.
Hi, nice to be here, Kathryn. And yes, I have looked around the world for those leaders and consciousness, and that's why when I met the Hurtaks, I felt like, oh, these are people that understand the direction of humanity can take, the upliftment of consciousness. That's why I've done over the last 20 years over 40 interviews with them for my New Realities program. And so it's been a great learning process and evolution for me dealing with these people.
Oh, that's so beautiful. That's excellent. I'd like to really jump right into it. And this is a somewhat of a fearless program. I'm very much connected to spirit and the power of spirit. And I would love to start off by hearing a little bit about the core experience of both yourself, JJ, and Desiree. But I'm aware, JJ, also that you have some really strong scientific background. You've worked with institutions, you work with NASA, you've worked with scientific technology. And so I'd like to give that as a base before we go into the spiritual revelations that you're able to share.
Yeah, thank you so much. I have a background with the Academy of Parapsychology and Medicine. Years ago, we worked with astronaut Mitchell and other leading members of the space program who in outer space were able to use mental signals without technology to send information that was mathematically coded in symbols to human biological targets on Mother Earth. I also have had the opportunity with my wife to lecture widely at major summits on consciousness, environmental studies, and cross-cultural understanding of what we need to do as a human society to overcome the public preoccupation with fear, with violence, with negativity through raising consciousness. And to that end, we've worked with leading musicians that I've been able to, quote-unquote, inspire indirectly, like Carlos Santana and Alice Coltrane, by the use of how mental pictures connect with the music of the mind and the body. And together, we orchestrate a whole new recipe of life that's fantastic. It's an indwelling of the music of the spheres the ancient artists and philosophers referred to.
Right. So some of our work has been with, as you mentioned, remote sensing technology, and that's really where the planes or satellites actually can look down on the Earth and see what is taking place. Now, we've used it for archaeology, and we've also used it for the environment and written papers on that. One of our other interests, and that of Elizabeth Rauscher, who you mentioned with our new book, Mind Dynamics, has been in writing reports and papers on the concept of, we'll say, the multi-universe that we live in. It's called the multiverse. And the idea that not only is this universe here, but scientists, including that of Scientific American, a very conservative scientific magazine, has come out with the possibilities that really the universe is multi-unfolding. So it's not just everything we see here with the Hubble telescope, but things that we can't see that are really blossoming in other realities. And we may never get to those other realms, those other universes, but it's just interesting to shift the perspective from everything being focused on planet Earth. And I think that's what's happening now in the 21st century, where we always thought it was, you know, God, the Earth, and everything around it. I always say, if this is the only planet God has to deal with, he's really not done a great job. But when you expand that to see what scientists are telling us about the multiverse, that there's many, not only other intelligences in this realm, but other universes, then you see a whole new perspective. And I believe that the two can merge, the spirituality and the science comes together.
So to put it simply, we are looking at science straighter than fiction. We're looking at the real X-Files of how behind the scenes governments, scientists and engineers, educators for the last 40 years have been looking at the power of the mind to work with these other dimensions. And we've come up with some surprising results published in our new book, Mind Dynamics.
And Dr. Hurtak mentioned also astronaut Mitchell, Edgar Mitchell. He was able to walk on the moon.
As the sixth astronaut.
And on his way back, and Alan knew him well, in fact, recorded some of television shows with him, that when he came back, he had this epiphany. But he also did some unique experiments, one with Ingo Swann, who was a resident of New York, a famous artist, but also a famous remote viewer, working with Stanford Research Institute. And the other was a man in the Midwest. And what he did, his name was Howard Sherman, and what he did was he sent signals back to these two men. And he said, did you get what I was sending you? And then when they compared notes, when astronaut Mitchell was in outer space coming back from the moon, sending these signals, the people on the Earth that he sent them to did get what he said. And that's an amazing interconnectedness that we're starting to understand now.
It is rather amazing. And I think all of us have had little incidents of this kind of thing happening. But to begin to recognize that this is just a capacity, a human capacity that can be developed, then that becomes very, very exciting. I would love also for you to talk a little bit more deeply about the work that you're doing, the depth of this work, because it really is an amazing thing when you think about that you are really going into history, really, as some people might think of it, or it might be the idea of connecting with the divine force and the divine consciousness. And I'm wondering if you could speak about that and how that has come forth into the mission of your work.
Of course, mystics have always felt connected with the universe, but unfortunately much of their language is poetic and vague and doesn't get really to the heart, pardon the pun, the heart of why it is, the heart math, the heart physics, the heart psychology is so important. Science has unfortunately become object-orientated rather than human-orientated. And here with our new areas of remote viewing, remote consciousness, remote perception, we're able to realize the subtle levels that we're linked with through compassion, through greater love, through greater designs of creativity. We see through the way the mind can image the color vibrations, the music vibrations. And so we place, we say, our work in the midst of a worldwide educational process where we're getting people to wake up and realize that we're all artists, musicians, and thinkers, and if we combine all of these energies together, we can open up a door to a whole new reality.
Right, and sticking to science a little bit longer, I mean, this is all part of quantum physics, and people like Deepak Chopra, but also medical doctors like Stuart Hameroff in Arizona have looked at what this is really saying. So, well, first of all, Einstein, he said that there was spooky interactions at a distance. He knew that. And what that means is that if you split a photon or a light particle into two parts, you can, and they've done this in Geneva, and they're actually testing it even into with some of the satellites and things like that. You send them 18 kilometers away. If you have two that are in once connected or entangled, if you change one and you flip one, the other one 18 kilometers away will actually flip, even though it's faster than the speed of light that they're flipping. And they're actually testing this with some of the telecommunications channels and networks. And it's a very sophisticated experiment that was done by Guichon and Sarlat in Geneva. But the idea is that we are interconnected, and even the photons of light react to one another if they are entangled at one point and then separated. And that is also starting to relate to what we think relates to our own consciousness, that our consciousness is interrelated. And Stuart Hameroff, who's a medical doctor, anesthesiologist, actually has looked at how the brain receives signals and information, and he's feeling that there's certain like microparticles in the brain, and that consciousness is not limited to our brain, but actually the brain is more like a receiver antenna for the consciousness field around the earth. And that gives us a lot of leeway, like in your program, I know you're interested in health and healing, that people can literally send healing energy to other people, and that interconnectedness that we all share can be felt and experienced. Alan, I'd love you to chime in with us because I know you have a lot to say on this as well.
Well, thanks. Yes, they've done experiments where they're in high crime areas, people have meditated and sent out prayers, and there was a documented reduction in the amount of crime in that area. So we exist within a field. Yes, we could send thoughts to each other, but there's a field of consciousness, and I think it's up to each one of us to help raise the collective field by sending out the highest, most positive thoughts that will connect to a greater good. And I think this is the work of your program, Kathy. This is what I'm trying to do. How do we change and raise up those that may not feel the evolution of consciousness, but yet we can have an impact because we're all part of the human field of consciousness.
Desiree and I have put together a number of books that illustrate how the mind works on several levels through color, through music, through a new type of physics from the heart. And it's very important that we go beyond simply the traditional level of mathematics and physics. which tends to be a bloodless abstraction, into the meat or the heart of how we are vibratory beings, all interconnected. There's really one person on this planet, and we're all part of this force of light and love that can be shared. We just have to understand the deeper significance of what Einstein and others like him, like Sir Arthur Eddington, were pointing at when they said, physics is the study of the structure of consciousness. Consciousness is that which reunites all of us together in terms of creativity, in terms of the powers of the mind-body extension.
And, you know, this is very, very practical ways for your listening audience. You can see this in sports. For football, for example, if you're there's a home field advantage. It's not just because they know the field. It's because you have the majority of people in the audience usually for that, you know, team. And there's a lot of energy. People know this. They don't consciously work with it, but they realize the home field advantage is also the consciousness advantage of everyone wanting that team to win. Of course, they don't always win. There can be circumstances and arrangements that don't, you know, work in that.
But it shows us how we're all connected. We may think we're sitting in our little apartment or someone listening to the radio might be isolated, but we're not. We're connected to each other through these thought waves, because thoughts are things. You can walk into a room and you can tell if someone had an argument because the air is different, the atmosphere. We have these inner senses, these inner ways of knowing. And this is what we're developing now at this time, the new senses that have been dormant but now are coming alive, like things like remote viewing that have been proven, actually not only proven, but the CIA used it for over 20 years to psychically spy on whatever they thought the enemy was. So these are ways that we're coming into a metaphysics of popular culture. I think that's why this program's so important. This is not stuff people normally talk about on a radio station, because it's been such a presence in new thought, new ideas, is able to present these ideas, and people are open to it. People are open to this now because there's a radical shift in the frequency of the planet, in the way people are thinking, and the coming together of our collective humanity. I mean, the internet itself demonstrates how connected we all are.
Right, there was something called the web bot on the internet for a little while, and it was someone who was getting the feel of what was going to happen, say, with the stock market or a particular stock, and they put that out, and then it was almost like once they put it out, then it definitely happened, because they told so many people. I think there was, you know, 500,000 people or more watching what was happening with the web bot. So they actually stopped doing it because they felt they were actually influencing reality too much. Now, a mother feels this about her child, even if the child is away. You can tell whether something's wrong or not wrong. And I always say, and this is a great thing to say, you can do it with your cell phone. And I know many people have tested this. Rupert Sheldrake, who's a famous cosmologist social scientist, has tested this with families that don't pick up your cell phone and just answer. Think of who's calling you when you hear your cell phone ringing. And if you practice that enough, you'll start figuring out who is calling you. You'll know before even it rings. That's what's so amazing. That's part of the whole remote viewing that we're experiencing right now. You can test and learn remote viewing just by picking up your cell phone, not looking first, but seeing who you think is calling you.
Mm-hmm. Well, even Roger Nelson, who was doing experiments at Princeton with the random coin toss and seeing patterns as the collective thought would come together, he called this the Global Consciousness Project, and he would have random number generators around the planet, and when there was a coming together, like some terrorist act or some even great celebration worldwide, there'd be a change in the randomness patterns of these formerly random numbers would start to come together, and that would be a signal that there was some kind of collective awareness happening. And this has been going on, well, it went on from 1980 to 2002, but it was marked the understanding that we are in a collective field. So these are practical experiments. People like Dean Radin at the Institute of Noetic Science are also doing experiments to show how we are connected to the field and how this field is influencing everybody. This whole idea of the 100th monkey theory was that when enough people received or had the impression of an idea, the idea would spread throughout the whole species. So I think if enough of us are in some kind of awareness of peace, the awareness that there needs to be a change and that there's possibilities for a peaceful, cohesive, loving planet, if enough people have that thought, I think the species would shift.
I agree. I totally agree. It's a kind of magic. It's a kind of magic. A kind of magic. One dream, one soul, one prize, one gold, one golden glance of what should be. It's a kind of magic. One shot. I would love to, at this point, shift to something a little practical that people can begin this exploration. And I have to say, the abundance of books and videos and information and classes that the two of you have, JJ and Desiree, are beyond belief, really. It's just an amazing body of work. But I would love if you could talk to us about the book End of Suffering. And the book is, while everybody suffers, most of this suffering is unnecessary and can be overcome. The message behind this book is how to overcome the polarity of opposites by combining the wisdom of the East with the findings of quantum physics to uncover a middle ground that shows opposing sides are really the same. So can you give us some insight from this book, The End of Suffering, please?
Yes, the subtitle of the book is Fearless Living in Troubled Times by my colleague Russell Targ and myself. It's based on research during the Cold War at Stanford Research Institute, where several of the sensitives, or those having psychic power, could, without the use of technology, reach around the world and see various military installations and technologies and describe them, look at the potential of how certain things can be move from a negative position to a positive position. That is to say, things could be remastered or reprogrammed by the power of the mind. And afterwards, notes were taken and verifications were made at the end of the Cold War by Russian scientists who remarkably agreed with the Americans that there was this great power of the mind that we could use for positive reasons. It did not have to be for building weapons of destruction. The greatest mass weapon system of the world is a mass construction system within our mind's eye, and if we can be able to use this and extend it around the world and see the world, humanity, as a global mind and interact as teachers and musicians and creative thinkers, not simply in a positive role by getting mice, so we say, to go around in the cage or look at things mathematically, but look at things musically and constructively, things can change. And this is the great aspect of the third path of how the scientific mind and the spiritual mind converge.
Right, and so it takes us also to the understanding that, of course, yes, if you're in a car accident and you lose your leg, you're going to have pain and suffering. I mean, nothing but drugs can help you in that one for at least the initial part. But in the latter part, or in the suffering that most people really feel, which is, you know, separations from others or the loss of someone, all these other things, if you understand what we've been saying, and if you understand remote viewing, that there is no separation, we'll say throughout the universe and probably even after death, that's of course a different subject, but it's still the same understanding, that there's no reason to suffer because you can be interconnected regardless of anything. So the book also couples with some of the Buddhist thinking of sunyata, not as emptiness, but as interconnectedness, that there's only the one thought, only the one unity, only the one spirit. And Russell Targ's daughter was well known for working with healing in this ability where, as I mentioned earlier, you can actually send thought forms and help people change, whether it's a consciousness change or even a physical change, just by putting out that energy. And she did some real serious tests at UC San Francisco Medical Center to look at healing modalities through remote abilities. And this is how healers work, of course, from a distance, or spiritual healers, we should call it. For the most part, the whole idea of the book really is saying that if you see yourself as an individual, you don't understand who you are. And to see yourself as part of the collective is really understanding the unity of spirit that we represent. And then at that point, there's no reason to suffer.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I think the source of all our suffering is to believe that we are our story, that we are separate from each other, just what we've been talking about. If we can see that we're really connected to something that's beyond who we thought we are, we can end the suffering by observing the events of the world instead of indulging in them.
Mm-hmm. So this is an esoteric book in the sense that it really is bringing people to a much deeper understanding of reality, pulling out of the drama of our everyday and really understanding that once we make that deeper connection, then all of the drama has a tendency to pale because it really isn't of substance. Am I conveying that correctly?
Yes, and it gives at the end about 5 points of understanding suggested practice, and one of it is very simply quiet the ongoing mental chatter and practice daily self-reflection, prayer, meditation, forgiveness, and gratitude. Because when you do that, you're opening yourself to really the positive thoughts of the universe, and you're beginning to see ways of helping others. And it also takes it out of helping only yourself. So there's also a shift that needs to take place in the understanding of the collective, that the individual is important in terms of its role it can play, but it also has to bring in the collective.
You know, I just want to say that the book opens with this New Yorker cartoon, which is one of my favorites, and this drunk guy is sitting at a bar, and he's yelling at the bartender, and he says, "Hey, pal, you have no idea who I think I am." And who we think we are is really the source of a lot of suffering because, you know, we get attached to that, and we get attached to these ideas, and this is what, you know, the Buddhists have been trying to tell us, this attachment is the source of all suffering. So this is an excellent book if people want to understand how they can transcend what they thought was their drama.
Exactly. And also we have declassified pictures and illustrations here, like in our other book, in Mind Dynamics, we've got over 200 different documents where people can see very clearly our experiments around the world. It's a good book for skeptics who want to, so we say, go through the laughter curtain and realize we're all interconnected. It's mm-hmm. just that we're trained to think that we're separate. We're trained to be specialists in sociology or music or mathematics or medicine. In essence, we are a composite of all of these. We are a living mosaic, what the ancients called a coat of many colors in the Bible, or in the Eastern traditions, a rainbow body. We are, shall we say, co-creators in the sense that we now have fantastic insights, and we must use it in this time of consciousness change throughout the world. Otherwise, the scripting of negativity we see constantly on the radio, the media, will bring us down as a world society. This is the opportunity for us to be beacons of light, or be, should we say, emissaries of a whole new conscience.
Absolutely.
Upraising of humanity. I want to say this very carefully because we're working with several areas of research. Desiree and I published a book many years ago, 40-some years ago, called The Keys of Enoch. I want to quote from that because that was based on a higher consciousness experience I had. I write, "Thus the direct relationship between the size of the universe, the diameter of the proton, and our range of vision is part of a larger mass energy space-time transformation we're all going through, which involves changes in our basic concept of the known universe. We're beginning to realize the universe is living with life, and we're part of it. We are part of a schoolhouse that's now opening up to the potential of a universal or consciousness university of amazing proportions and dimensions. And we have to get beyond the dualistic limitations that have allowed the old paradigms of power, of masculine domination, of cultural separation, and of religious ideology that have separated us to go to the side and make way for a whole new type of civilization based upon consciousness that has the divine spark and the divine love as its potential."
Beautiful. Thank you very much for sharing that. And, you know, I do hope that we can have subsequent programs in which we can go much deeper into all these topics, because your teaching goes very deep and it also has a broad spectrum.
Inside my skin, there is this space. It twists and turns, it bleeds and aches. Inside my heart, there's an empty room. It's waiting for lightning, it's waiting for you. And I am wanting, I am needing you here inside.
I'd love for each of you to tell us a little bit about this DVD, Pathway to Conscious Living. And it's a DVD produced by Ellen Steinfeld, who hosts it, with Joe Dispenza, as well as JJ and Desiree Hurtak and Marilyn Schlitz. And this is an intriguing discussion on creating this pathway to conscious living. And I'm wondering if you could give us a little information about this DVD.
Well, I'll just jump in. As you said, I've been doing my program, New Realities, on Time Warner Cable, and also now it's on YouTube, and it's gotten very popular. And I look for the people at the cutting edge, and Joe Dispenza is someone I've known for a long time, and he's developed a way of working with the brain and consciousness in order to create ideas that can be fulfilled by focusing on them and putting out a positive sense, a kind of believing that it already has happened. And he's been able to do lots of very interesting experiments where people have grown back teeth and had miraculous healings because of these intentions that people put out within well, he's written a book called Evolve Your Brain, within the evolution of consciousness that each of us are a part of. And Marilyn Schlitz was also the head of the Institute of Noetic Science that Edgar Mitchell founded because of this epiphany he had in space. And then along with Drs. JJ and Desiree Hurtak, who are very much into the power of the mind, the idea that we are more than our body, that there's a higher calling. So I wanted to put together a panel discussion that reflected how we can go into the future and create the world each of us really intends to live in, that how we can create the society that is calling us beyond the war and the kind of prejudices and the inequities that we see every day in the newspaper. So how can we build this new society? And this was the foundation of this discussion that I think proved to have some excellent results. Mm-hmm. Desiree?
Yeah. Well, it's an amazing group of people that Alan has brought together, and Joe Dispenza is still going everywhere. Marilyn Schlitz actually worked with Elizabeth Targ, the daughter of Russell, as I talked about, in terms of some of the healing modalities. The whole idea, though, in a nutshell, is to really understand how powerful our minds are. And in a sense, it's good that we have maybe in some cases limited our abilities because we have to develop the heart. And once the heart can come forward and the love can share and really emanate what is necessary, then the power of the mind can really go out and change the world. And I think that's the stage that we're in, and I think that's what Joe Dispenza and Marilyn and Dr. Jack and I are really talking about, that when you develop that heart consciousness, literally linking the two, and I love the name of your program again, that in that case, we can empower each other and ourselves to literally transform the planet, and if nothing else, transform our lives. I think that many people have gotten insights now, and they've seen what's called synchronicities in their lives that they couldn't have, you know, done in a million years. And these things are happening to people now. The question is why. We can go into that and maybe in another program. But the idea is that the power of consciousness seems to be coming more to the fore, and we're able to use it more, and we're able to literally transform our families first, because that's very important, because many people, you know, look at the divorce rate on, you know, in this continent alone, it's extremely high. But if we had that love, if we had that foresight, if we had that insight, then we can look at the problems from not only our own perspective, but from a more outside of ourselves looking in perspective, I think we can change the reality of this planet. And I think that happens on all levels, from politics to economics, and also to personal realities. And that's really what all of us, Marilyn, Joe, Dr. Tech, and I are saying, that the power of the mind is powerful.
So what we're discovering is that we are multidimensional beings, and consciousness must be considered to be the whole process of connecting life with life and also future life. And as we begin to raise our consciousness and find its creativity works both in our conscious states as well as our unconscious states, we can orchestrate them by positive thinking and, shall we say, modalities of color, perception, comprehension, and that amplifies our abilities not only in the mental, the physical, the psychological, emotional, but as Desiree and Ellen have shared, it influences areas of medicine, education, creativity, philosophy, and society as a whole. And this is all the more important because consciousness, as we know from our work with the astronauts, also extends into outer space. And I want to emphasize the fact that we're beginning to realize that consciousness also gives us the ability of interspecies communication with the animals, with plant life, other forms of intelligence.
Right. Animals, for sure, and this is something also Rupert Sheldrake has shown, really from afar can tell when you're coming home. Your dog, who's been sleeping all day, if you are like even 20 miles away and say, I'm coming home, he's had a camera on the dog, it'll jump up and run to the door. It knows what's going on. We have not known we have that same ability. And as soon as we get out of our little box and start realizing our own potentials and using it with love and compassion and a desire to be of service, then really our whole reality can change, and it is changing for many people.
Absolutely.
You see, I think what we're talking about here and also on this panel is that there's a science. It's not just, oh, it's mystical, oh, it's positive thinking. There's a science behind thought. There's a science behind intention. And this is what we have to wake up to, graduate to, looking at the world differently, but not forgetting the scientific validations that the mainstream world needs. But are they willing to look at the consequences of these new sciences? I hope so. And presenting guests like this on my show, I feel more and more people can be exposed to a new way of thinking, a new paradigm that includes the mind as a instrument of causality. I think that's what we're really talking about here, and to show proof of this with the experiments of Rupert Sheldrake or Roger Nelson or even Dean Radin, who's trying to show there is a intentional override to reality. Even quantum physics is showing that the observer influences the observed. So this is the new time we're coming into, and this is what science has to wake up to, that there's new possibilities that prove the existence of this higher consciousness.
Here we have a new textbook, over 200 experiments documented by the best scientists in the world, called Mind Dynamics in Space and Time. I want to emphasize this to educators, journalists, and people throughout the media, that we are moving very quickly into a whole new reevaluation of life, and we are also beginning to understand this extends far beyond the nation state. It pertains to a global awakening of how world humanity can activate a whole new mind, a whole new civilization, a whole new possibility of reaching out into what I call a space-kind civilization with no limits of being earthbound anymore.
But it also comes down to each of us because, you know, if we wake up in the morning and our thoughts are always negative, it's basically we're receiving from the consciousness field, this is a new way of looking at it, these negative scenarios because we like to play in the negativity. We can just as easily shift to what quantum physics is saying is the infinite possibilities that we can choose from, because there's always infinite possibilities in the universe. That's how you get the multi-universes. And by doing that, we're able to pull in the positive possibilities that can change our life. Now, what this really means, in a certain sense, is that we're able to shift. And the easiest way to do it is not to try to do it through mind control, which some people do, or through Zen meditations and other ways, but I believe the easiest way to do it is simply through love. And if you love and want to help and transform really the way you're thinking of things, then you get the thought forms that come to you that allow you to make that difference in society and in the world and with people around you. So it's not a matter of like thought control, which many people try to do and lose out very quickly, but if you just simply have love, those thoughts start coming to you. You need some wisdom as well to know what's happening and some discernment, but basically it comes down to love.
So we're speaking of love with a capital L, the altruistic gene that we begin to find that we have within us, this fantastic potential that we have ignored through negative thinking. And as we begin to realize that we can change our evolution, that is to say we can reprogram ourselves from top to bottom, we begin to open up a whole new vector of experience with other levels of intelligence that spiritual thinkers and philosophers refer to as the angelic or the ultra-terrestrial. And so our work has also included work with the astronauts, leading shamans and spiritual thinkers in other parts of the world who claim contact with the higher worlds, that we are being watched as a human civilization, and we are at a crucial point. Will we go down with climate change, with a new round of religious war and hostility, or will we bootstrap a whole new reality through the higher powers of consciousness and the loving design that connects all of us, not only as humans to humans, but humans to what I call the higher evolutionary intelligence?
Right. And one more thing I want to add is are we choosing to be at the effect of this collective consciousness, or are we choosing to be the cause? Are we choosing to contribute to what's possible, or are we just here to react to what's going on? Can we make it? We can make a difference with our thoughts by intention, and that takes us out of the kind of victim modality and into those that want to create the new realities. And this is, I think, the task at this real crossroads that we are at in our culture, in our time, as global citizens. How is it going to be? Are we going to take action, or are we going to be reactive?
Yeah, and the real power in this, I believe, is that we're not talking about running out into the street. We're not talking about picking up arms. We're not talking about conflict at all. You're talking about reaching into this deeper connection that we have that's simply a part of who we are as beings. It's just that we have been denied this information, and I think that's really an important point to make. And I'm wondering, in the few minutes that we do have, if JJ and Desiree, you could talk a little bit more about this connection with Enoch and with these realms that are with us, that are intermingled with us, but are at a vibration that has much more peace, much more intelligence, or much more capacity than we've been exhibiting as human beings. Can you speak of that inner journey that's also a part of your work?
Right. Well, it also takes a consciousness awakening, because most people in this world now think that, it's only us. And once you start looking outside the box and seeing these other possibilities, you start reaching into the idea that it's not just the global consciousness or the global mind, but there's actually other thoughts and energies around in the universe. And that as we develop, as I was mentioning, synchronicity, I mean, it's amazing things that are happening, but it's not what our take on it is. It's not just happening because of the individual or even the few people in our circle, but it's happening because there's a whole consciousness universal change that's taking place. So what is out there in the universe? That's the real question. Well, we believe that there are extraterrestrial life forms, many, multiple. Even someone in Canada that used to be the Minister of Defense, his name is Paul Hellyer, says that there's five different extraterrestrial races that are been known and reported on in findings and of reports from UFO connections. But we take it another step further. We go beyond the extraterrestrial to the ultra-terrestrial, and we say, well, behind all the physicalness of this reality, there's a multidimensional, we'll say, invisible world, and the angels are real. The consciousness of the divine is real, and there's myriads of energies and entities there as well.
And we define this in a book called The Keys of Enoch, which is a paraphysical textbook explaining how the power of the mind does link us with different levels, and we can choose to work with those who are kind, benevolent, and work with the humanity as a whole, as opposed to those who work with heavy metal technology that tend to confuse in the minds of government scientists the real purpose of contact with the other worlds. Clearly, we are at a threshold where quantum change is going to take place. And if we use our energies collectively, I believe we will make the right choice.
And we do encourage meditation. We encourage prayer, whatever your mode of religious belief is, or even consciousness expansion into those realms. We actually have extensive music and DVDs that are available in terms of visualizations to understand this. And we feel the music is really important, because the body really is vibration. Everything here around us is vibration. It looks solid, but if you look at it under, you know, an X-ray machine, it's atoms and particles moving and vibrating. And that's where we can influence the energies around us.
And as we expand with spiritual music, we understand the mind can open up other areas of its consciousness through what is called musical linguistics, or the use of sacred sounds and sacred melodies, the names of God or the names of divine experience. For example, in the ancient Sanskrit or the Hebrew or the Aramaic or any one of the great language traditions invariably involves around the ability to think in mental pictures and see the multicolored aspects of the humanity together, working, participating as the divine humanity. And so it's the higher threshold, which physicists call the non-local aspect of realizing we're here, but we're also participating on the higher threshold, what is called a higher mind or an overself, that links us together if we want to go into that higher path.
Right. We believe that we actually have a higher self, and that the physical form in this reality is only one aspect of the higher self. And actually, that higher self can help to heal us, direct us, and guide us as well.
Mm-hmm. Alan, you want
to... What's drawn me to the work of the Hurtaks is that when you open the book, Keys of Enoch, Book of Knowledge, by reading a paragraph, you get these visions of many, many levels. It's not really a linear book, but it actually connects the reader to a multidimensional awareness. And that's why I've been fascinated with their work and lots of people who talk about these multidimensional aspects, because we're beginning to realize who we really are, that we're not this being limited to time and space, but we have a facility to access these other parts, these other dimensions, and actually reading the Book of Enoch will do that, because it's so complex, and it works on so many different levels. It inspires this awakening of the greater mind.
Exactly. And as I was saying, the amount of work available by the Hurtaks is dimensional. I mean, it's so incredible that I think people could study it for many years to come. There's so much there. Alan, it would be nice also, we have another feature with USB flash drive. It's called, we're calling it Chronicles of the Key. And this flash drive is actually contains some interviews that you've done with the Hurtaks from 1997 to 2017. There are actually 24 videos, almost about 8.5 hours of material. Can you speak about this work that you're making available?
It's like 15 hours, really, when you add
15, okay.
Yeah, and that's, it's an incredible body of work. I mean, I've interviewed thousands of people in the metaphysical field, but consistently I come back to the teachings of the Hurtaks, because they include their investigations into ancient archaeology and physics and biology. So for me, it's an all-encompassing overview that, yes, starting in 1997, for the last 20 years, I've been coming back to this teaching and integrating with other people that I've also studied with, and seeing that this is a whole body of thought that connects the physics with the mental, with the metaphysics and the higher mind. So they'll get quite an education in metaphysics, in the awakening of higher consciousness, the over-self book that they've also written, the Hurtaks. There's different features, aspects of the divine feminine. So, 72 sacred names. There's many aspects to these teachings that are inspirational, and depending where you're coming from in your own background, in your own spiritual development, I think this will talk to many, many people. It's an exciting body of work that I'm very proud of, that we've, three of us, have had the consistency to keep pursuing the leading edge topics in epigenetics and metaphysics and in mind expansion. 15 hours of videos that have happened over the last 20 years. There's clips of different ones on YouTube, 24 distinct videos and 15 hours of teachings that I think will inspire people to wake up to who they really are, to have a framework to put their higher dimensional experience in, and to pursue themselves as the creators of their own reality, which is really the goal, is the fact that we are these sovereign beings and we're waking up to this greater sense of who we are. So that's the intention behind it, and I think it'll be a great inspiration.
And as we come to the completion of this interview, I wanted to offer you, JJ and Desiree, if you have a final thought you'd like to share with people, maybe give your website so they can do more research on the work that you do.
Right. Well, so our website is www.keysofenoch.org or also futurescience.org. Overall, we want to have people start to think outside the box, use their higher consciousness because it's there. You have that ability. Know you have that ability. And also share love. Come from a place of compassion, service, and love.
And remember, the Keys of Enoch teach that our soul is doomed to perfection. We are part of a cosmic university. We are part of a higher design, waking up to our potential in the vast and awesome universe. It's for us now to use these gifts of divine spirit to reach out to the world and make significant changes. And so let us begin to realize a daily transformation is possible. And to that end, I want to thank you, Kathryn, for inviting us and also our audience throughout the world. Be aware that Alice Coltrane, the great musician, composer, well, wife of John Coltrane, went into spirituality because she felt the jazz world was great, but it wasn't great enough. The love of God had to be expressed in spiritual music and spiritual thought forms. We collaborated together. This work has never been released, but will be released. We're reaching a threshold where the world has to sing and feel the joy of the divine spark. And so we thank all of you. Keep in touch with us through your heartbeat of a miracle every second.
Thank you very much for joining me, and I want to ask all of our listeners to stay tuned.